and stand with us. Amen. Praise God. I'm glad the Lord gives us the victory. Amen. I don't know if I've ever felt so much just pressure this past few days. Has anybody else felt it? Amen. I can tell you just pressure all about me. But I know I've got the victory. Victory, victory shall be mine. Victory shall be mine. Oh, hallelujah. I can tell you the devil would love to stop what God's doing here. But Jesus ain't going to let him. John chapter 5 and verse 1. John 5, verse 1. Amen. Before we get in, I'd like to say a big, big, big happy birthday to my beautiful wife. Happy birthday, Melissa. Amen. John chapter 5, verse 1. The Bible says, after this, there was a feast of the Jews. And Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market or gate a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. A certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie, knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, sir, I have no man, when the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus said unto him, rise. Somebody say, get up. Take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. In Psalm 118, verse 8, the Bible says, it is better. Somebody say, better. To trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. I want to preach to you this morning on this thought. Sir, I have no man. Sir, I have no man. Now, this isn't for all the single ladies out there looking for a man. Just clarify that. Sir, I have no man. Would you help me pray? Father, we love you. We thank you, Lord, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I thank you, Lord, for every person, God, that you have brought into your house today. Lord, I look across this congregation and I see, Lord, a myriad of people, Lord, that experience different battles and different struggles, Lord. But I see people, Lord, that are here because their heart is for you. I pray, oh Lord, that you would open this place up and you would shake the heavens, oh God. And Lord, you would anoint and let there be clarity of thought and clarity in hearing, Father. That the seed of the eternal word of God would find hearts that have been prepared to receive the word of the Lord. I pray, God, that you would have your way in Jesus' mighty, wonderful name. And God's people shouted, amen. You may be seated. Preaching, sir, I have no man. Now, here in our text this morning, we find an environment of great need. We find that the blind needed sight, the limp needed strength, and the withered needed the freshness of God. John 5:1 says, after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, of halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. Now the word impotent here means to be sick, feeble, or weak. John tells us that there was here at the pool of Bethesda, that a great multitude of these types of people were stationed. Everywhere you were to look in this environment, you would have seen someone that had an issue. There would have been blind people. There would have been withered people. There would have been halt people all about you. I believe that they were all there for the right reason. They all wanted to be touched of God by the miracle powers that were found in the water. They didn't want to live blind. They didn't want to live halt. And they didn't want to live withered. They wanted to live free. They wanted to live whole. And they wanted to live in the freshness of God Almighty. For that is why they were gathered at this pool. You see, they could have been gathered at the bar. They could have been gathered at the arena. Or they could have been gathered at the drug house. But here they are at the pool of Bethesda. Couldn't we say this morning that that is why that you and I are gathered here today? We are gathered as a people in desperate need, amen. Couldn't we also say that this is the people, that this is the type of people that we want to fill PAG, combined with those who know what it is like to want to be in that position, amen. I don't know about you, but here this morning, I want the blind. I want those that are halt, and I want those that are withered, amen, to come and to sit on these empty chairs, hallelujah. People that are in desperate need of a touch that only God can give. Because let me tell you today that this world does not have what you need, amen. But what you need is in the Lord Jesus Christ. It is His forgiveness that you need. It is His power that you need. It is His love that you need. It is His mercy that you need. But let me tell you, what is a gathering at the pool if you can't look about you and see those which were like you, amen. 1 Corinthians 6:11 says, and such were some of you, amen. But you are washed, but you are sanctified, but you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of God, amen. I can tell you, if I look over here and all I see is blind people, and all I see is blind people over here that would testify to me, there's no hope in God. But let me tell you, I used to be blind, but now I see. That you can be touched of God. You can be ministered to by God. You can be healed by God. You can be delivered by God. There is one that sits above this earth. This earth is His footstool, and you can go to Him in the time of trouble, and He can deliver your soul, giving praise. Yeah. Hallelujah. I tell you, it do us no good, none of us, if we were all just the way that we once were. Amen. As we look at this text, there are four things that I would like to convey to you. The first is this. It is right. Somebody say right. Right. For those who need a touch and a miracle from God to place themselves in environments that are conducive to such touches and miracles. Scripture tells us there was at Jerusalem by the sheep market or sheep gate a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. The Word of God and history books teach us much about this location in Jerusalem. Nehemiah 3:1 says, then Eliashib the high priest rose up with his brethren the priests, and they builded the sheep gate. They sanctified it and set up the doors of it. One able commentary states, the pool is near the sheep gate on the north end of the Temple Mount. The gate is mentioned in Nehemiah and may have been used for sheep being brought to the temple for sacrifice. The pool would therefore be used to wash the sheep before they were brought into the temple for sacrifice. This means that the pool was not the sort of place where classy people went to wash before entering the temple. The fact that a number of invalids are waiting for the water to stir to be healed means that the pool was a gathering for lower class people, the sick and the injured. Let me just tell you this morning that the church is for such people. It is for the hurting. It is for the broken. You may say to yourself, I don't want to rub shoulders with that class of people. But let me tell you this morning that God's holy church is filled with those, amen. This water may be stinky at times. It may have a lot of sheep residue at times. But nonetheless, it is in these waters that God has made a way for the healing of people, amen. I can tell you, there's a lot of people, they don't like getting down and dirty in a prayer altar, amen. But here at PAG, we will combine our tears with yours. We will sing our song with your song. We will get down. We will get dirty. We'll get in the place that you are, because why? It is in these waters that God meets his people. He'll meet you today. He'll meet you on Wednesday. He'll meet you on Sunday. But if we ever become a type of people that says our tie is too straight, our shoes are too shine to reach down into the muck and into the mire, we might as well write Ichabod above the door. But here this morning, that's not the church that we are. We are a people that says, send us the deplorable of the world, and we'll see the God of heaven reach down and pick them up and put their feet on high ground, turn them around, because that is what God does. Give him praise. Hallelujah. You see, we know that Christ called the believer sheep. He said, my sheep know my voice. We also know that the believer is to present their bodies a living sacrifice. We know that the name Bethesda means the house of mercy. How many of you need some mercy? Amen. Scripture also conveys that the number 5 is the number of grace. And we find that there were 5 porches at the pool of Bethesda. Putting all of this together, could we not say that this pool was a type of the true church? A place where Christ's sheep gathered. A place where you find a certain cleansing by the word of God. A place where you can find mercy. And a place where you can find grace. Amen. I don't know about you, but I want those things to be found in my life every day of my life. I want to gather. I want to preach the word of God. I want to be cleansed by the word. And I need all the mercy and all the grace that God can sum up to give this preacher. I can tell you, that's a type of the church. We say all of this to simply applaud these people for being in the right environment, amen. They all understood that they needed a miracle from God, and placing themselves in such an environment gave them the greatest possibility for that miracle, amen. We must come to understand that we too should place ourselves in the right environment. If we need healing, a touch from God, strength, and so forth, then the house of God, prayer meetings, camp meetings, revivals, and personal time with God in his presence is where we need to fix our bodies. Amen. I can tell you, I applaud all of these invalids. Why would you do that, Pastor? Because they understood that God was a moving at the pool of Bethesda. And here, I'm no dummy. I learned a long time ago for me to get this old carcass, Brother Dallin, and put it where God's a moving. If I need the Lord to heal my body, if I need the Lord to fill me with the Holy Ghost, get me in the middle of a red hot Pentecostal service where the rains are falling, the winds are blowing. I need God to move in my life. Hallelujah. You see, we need to get to Bethesda as much and as often as we possibly can. And it is in this environment that we must continuously abide in a disposition of expectant waiting. John 5:3 says, in these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting, somebody say waiting, for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled. Sometimes there's trouble. The water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in and was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. This word waiting means expecting, waiting for, looking for, or tarrying until. We find that the Word of God says a lot about waiting. Psalm 62:5, my soul, wait thou only upon God, for my expectation is from Him. Isaiah 40:31, we all know this, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with eagles, wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Amen. 2 Thessalonians 3:5 says, patiently waiting for the coming of Christ. Scripture says about Simeon that he was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. Amen. I can tell you, in the house of God and in this walk with God, there are times of waiting. There are times of waiting. We know in the Word of God that they waited till they heard the sound in the mulberry bushes. We know that they waited until the 7th day to shout. And we know they waited to break their pot until Gideon said to do it. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying, think about all these invalids sitting there. They're expected waiting. They didn't know when the eastern sky would split. They didn't know when the Holy Ghost would break forth into the service, but they're sure enough waiting. And the moment it happens, they're not going to sit on their backside. They're not going to wonder, get caught up in daydreaming in church. No, no. When the waters were troubled, they said to themselves, I'm going to get down in the midst of the water. I know that God's a moving. My victory is now. Folks, I can tell you, you never want to get caught up in the flesh when your moment of deliverance comes. Did you hear me? I can tell you, it's very easy to get caught up in grocery lists, the temperature of rooms. Oh, come on, somebody. It's very easy to get caught up in a lot of other things. I can assure you of that. I know the devil all the time. Why does that happen? Because he didn't want you to be in a place of expectant waiting. He wants you to miss it. He wants you. You know, the Bible says that Bartimaeus cried out to the Lord. Jesus was going to pass him by. I can tell you, we sang the song, don't pass me by, Lord. But I can tell you, if your mind is caught up in 1,000 other things, you'll miss your deliverance. You'll miss your victory. God may want to fill you with the Holy Ghost, and if you'll just sit waiting, oh God, I can't wait until I feel your presence come in the room. I'm going to throw those hands up. I'm going to shout to God and get the victory that I know God desires. Hallelujah. Couldn't we say there are those that even missed their opportunity to be made whole simply because they caught up in looking at the other invalid? Come on, somebody. I can tell you, you can get caught up looking at invalids and miss out. There's 15 people in the water. Come on. I said, there's those that have gone before you. Matthew Henry said, the troubling of the water was the signal. Somebody say signal. Given of the descent of the angel. As the going up on the tops of the mulberry trees was to David. And then they must bestir themselves. The waters of the sanctuary are then healing when they are put in motion. Ministers must stir up the gift that is in them. When they are cold and dull in their ministrations, the waters settle and are not apt to heal. The angel descended to stir the water. Not daily, perhaps, not frequently, but at a certain season. Some think at the three solemn feasts to grace those solemnities, or now and then, as infinite wisdom saw fit. God is a free agent in dispensing his favors. Amen. In other words, sometimes you've got to have a preacher. Sometimes you've got to have a singer. Sometimes you've got to have a child of God to stir things up. Amen. There's been many a times we gathered here Wednesday night, and I felt in my heart, Robin, you better stir this thing.
thing up. Amen. I can assure you, but when it's stirred up, when there's faith to believe for salvation, don't you sit there saying, I'll get saved tomorrow. I'll get filled tomorrow. I'll get delivered tomorrow. I'll get my marriage back together tomorrow. But you take that love bunny's hand. You stand up. You begin to march around the house of God. You let the Lord do it in your life and see the goodness of God.
Folks, I say all the time, don't you sit there if the Holy Ghost is moving. I can tell you there's going to be a divine burst of faith that comes into your spirit, Sister Donna. And in a moment of time, you feel I can be healed right now. You may wait 10 seconds down the road, Brother Josh, and that feeling will pass you by. But I learned a long time ago, when I feel the shout, Sister Lord, I shout. When I feel the clap, I clap. If I feel the stand, I stand. If I feel a hallelujah in my spirit, I shout to the top of my lungs, hallelujah, glory, praise God. And all of a sudden, when I move in response to the stirring of the water, I can tell you, I feel a victory in my soul, a victory this world cannot give me.
I can tell you, look at the old people that operated in healing ministry. They would feel it's time to lay hands on the sick.
And wait till your faith was there to believe God for your healing. There was preachers, Brother Mike, would preach for hours. They would wait until they felt that the whole congregation was under the conviction of sin. And then they would say, the waters are now stirred. Amen. I don't know about you, but I have no desire to jump into an unstirred message, to jump into an unstirred ministry, to jump into an unstirred church or an unstirred. Come on, somebody. But you show me a preacher with the stirring of God in his soul. You show me a church with the stirring of God in its waters. I'll jump in every time. I'll become a diver. Jump in, whatever it takes. I'll jump in that water. All I'm saying, Pottsville, is let's stir the water. Let's make an environment for people to be healed. Giving praise in his house. Hallelujah. Stir yourself up.
I can tell you, I'd walk out the door. I didn't feel a stirring in the message.
Oh, keep your religion to yourself. If it don't stir you and keep you faithful, I don't want what you got. Oh, come on, somebody. Stir yourself up and watch the people jump. Come on. I want you to know, even in this environment, that man has to be a part of what God is doing. Charles Spurgeon said, beware of forgetting why you are here. Beware of coming to the house of God and not knowing why you come. I've said that years ago. You went to places of worship in the hope of finding salvation. Well, you have kept coming and you have not found it. Do you still look for it? Have you not fallen into the habit of sitting and listening to sermons, prayers, and so on, without feeling that you came for anything special for yourself? You come and go merely that you may attend a place of worship. That is all. The Savior would not let the impotent man lie there, satisfied because he was by the pool. No, no. He said to him, why are you here? Have you not some desire? Do you want to be made whole? Amen. I can tell you, even though the waters are stirred at Pottsville, you can forget why you walk through those doors. You walk through those doors, hopefully, not to sit in your sin, to sit in your complacency, and to sit in your impotency, but to come, to get in the waters of God, to participate in what the Lord is doing.
God has to say to the man, why'd you even come to church this morning? Why even here? Why'd you come? Have you forgot why you come? Listen to me. God uses us as co-laborers to create environments that are conducive to people receiving from the Lord. Amen. Let me tell you something. God alone heals. He alone fills with the Holy Ghost. Not this preacher. I'm not your savior. Come on, somebody. I'm not your healer. Come on, somebody. Come on. We are co-laborers with God, but I do want you to know something, that you and I create environments that are conducive to the longevity of people's desire to receive a touch from God. The Bible says this, that there were five porches at the pool of Bethesda. Now, God didn't build the porches. I said, God didn't build the porches. God took care of what he could take care of. He's the one that gave the Holy Ghost. He's the one that troubled the water. They could not create water as much as they could create. It's troubling a man. But what they could do is go grab a hammer and go grab some mortar and go grab some bricks or whatever else. Go get some rocks from the quarry and say, you know what? I'm going to make this as easy for people to get a touch of God as I can. I'm going to build five porches for them. I'm going to give them a place where they can go into the water, very accessible. Why? Because I want them to be whole.
Come on. I can tell you, me, PAG, we can build porches. I love that song that says, I know a man that can. Listen, me putting these porches up every Sunday, seeking the Lord for the word for you. I'm just building you a porch, man. That's all I'm doing, Brother David. I'm building five porches for you so you can get as close to the water as you can, and you can be there as long as you need to be there, waiting for the Lord to touch your life. What we're doing with Melita is we're simply building porches, saying we are not the answer, but let us build something as close to the answer as we can build it, that Jesus is still the answer.
That Jesus is your answer. This preacher is not your answer. Brother Larry, Jesus is your answer. And if I can make it as easily accessible, amen, as I can for you to get to him. I mean, when you're in Potent, you got to have a porch, really. That's why they have rooms and they have things in hotels that you call. So I need a handicap room. Come on. Because I can't reach over. What are you saying we're doing here at Pottsville? I'm building you the right bathtub, man, so you can get in every time you need a touch of God. You can bring your impotency in here. I'm going to have things on the wall that your blindness can reach so you can get to Jesus. Amen. What are you saying, Pastor? All I'm trying to do is facilitate a meeting between the Savior of the world and your soul. I'm just trying to make an introduction. Amen. My God, won't you use the chariot of this message simply to usher you, Brother Dallas, into the presence of God, not for you to say, look at him, but my God, let this ministry get you to Christ. My God,
and let it be done in the grace.
He built five, not six, that would emphasize man, but five. Five, 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 grace, five. Let it be the grace of God
I present to you, the Lord Jesus Christ in. I pray for everybody in this room, whoever you are, that you say, Pastor, you make it easy to get to Jesus. You make it possible to believe that he can do anything. He can work in any way. He can save the worst of these. I can tell you, if I have not done that, then I have failed you as your pastor. Charles Spurgeon once said, you might not always get what you want, but you always get what you expect. We must come to see that even in this environment that has been set for an ease in relation to a touch of God, that it's very easy in this disposition of expectant waiting for the child of God to allow man, somebody say man, to become the focal point of their desire. John 5, 6 through 7 says, when Jesus saw him lie, how many know Jesus sees when you lie? Knew that he had been now a long time. God knows how long you've been in that trial. He knows. Somebody say he knows.
He knows.
It's not past him. He said unto him, would thou be made whole?
Come on. Are you going to be made whole? Wilt thou be made whole? The potent man answered him, said, sir, I have no man. When the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. In these verses, we find a man who was at the right place and who possessed the right disposition, but who had the wrong focus. He had allowed man to become the focus, the center, and ultimately the excuse for why he remained in his current condition. Brother Clendenin once said, you have not truly repented until you stop blaming others for why you are the way that you are. We find that it wasn't that this man didn't move toward the water. It was simply that someone always stepped down in front of him. I've come to learn that the statement, sir, I have no man, has caused more preachers, believers, and churches to miss out with God than anything else. Believers often say, in not so many words, sir, I have no man to have a good marriage. Sir, I have no man to reach the world for Christ. Sir, I have no man to be faithful to the house of God. Sir, I have no man to do what God has called me to do. Sir, I have no man to be a vital part of the local assembly. It is not that people are not in the right place and are not in expectant waiting. It is simply that they have allowed man, somebody say man, to become their focus and ultimately their excuse. Man becomes the focus of the church. Man will eventually become the excuse of the church. I don't serve God because such and such. I don't live for the Lord because I can't do. Come on. I learned a long time ago, when man is the focus, ministry is a frenzy. I don't need man. I need Jesus. That's who I need. I go to these conventions or whatever else. I'm not there to pass out 1,000 cards. I'm just there because I need Jesus. Amen. I learned a long time ago, if God be for me, who can be against me? If God is on my side, I shall walk in the victory. I shall preach to every soul he wants me preaching to. I shall pastor every person he wants me to pastor. Jesus said, I've lost none but the one, the son of perdition. Everyone Jesus was to keep, he kept. Amen. I believe it. However, Christ shifts the man's focus off of man and into the Son of Man. Christ said, Jesus said unto him, rise, take up thy bed and walk. In this, Christ was saying to this impotent man that Christ himself was to be the focus, even in the church. Even in the church, even in the place of mercy, even in the place of grace, even in the place of stirring, that man was not to be the focus, that Jesus is to be the focus, that every message I preach point you to Christ, that every song we sing point you to Christ. As Peter said, it's not me that you have come up and walk. It is in the name of Jesus. It is Christ alone that is the healer and the savior of the world. Christ alone. However, it is he that walkest amongst the candlesticks that should be the focus, the center, and the focal point. Brother Jason, as you come, we sing the song, get your mind on Jesus, and let's have church. Because could I submit to you, until your mind's on Jesus, you're just going through religious rigmarole. Did you hear me? You must see Christ and all things. Reason this song is saying, because we understand that until our eyes are on the Lord Jesus Christ, then blindness, limping, dryness, impotence, and excuse will always prevail. However, if our eyes can look unto Jesus, then we will find that he is the author, the finisher of our faith. Psalm 146:3 says, put not your trust in princes, nor in the sons of man, in whom there is no help. Psalm 118:8 says, it is better to trust the Lord than to put confidence in man. I can assure you, if I would have looked to man, I would have quit a long, 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 long time ago. But I come to realize there is a Savior. There is one. His name is Jesus. Can you say his name with me? Jesus. 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 In Christ. Listen to me. In Christ, I'm not trying to beat another believer, preacher, or church into the pool. Let me say that again. In Christ, I'm not trying to beat another preacher, believer, or church into the pool. I'm simply trying to respond to his words towards my life. I'm not trying to beat the church down the road by the bill into that pool. That's a frenzy. For long, you'll find you're punching them on the way. Oh, you're not hearing me. I'm not in competition with all these other impotent folk. I've just realized that the stirring of the waters in the Son of God. I can go to him. He can go to all of us at the same time. Simultaneously, he can go to you, Sister Phil. He can go to you, Brother David. All around, he can go to every person in this room. I'm glad the Lord delivered me from trying to beat preachers into pools. Because they're a lot faster than me. Come on. Sister Bailey, but I do know one. It comes to me on a daily basis and says, Robin, would thou be made whole? Yes, Lord, I so desire that. I do want to be made whole. I mean, coming to church don't mean you want nothing. You can be here and not want a thing but to get to lunch. Come on, somebody. So Jesus asked, would thou be made whole, Brother Johnny? Is that why you come to the pool of Bethesda today? Because you want to be whole. Are you willing to respond to my word when I tell you? Yes, Lord. Oh, rise up, pick up your bed, and walk. You know how that man, he could have said, yes, Lord, I want to be made whole. But it was validated by his action. It's exactly what he did. Jesus said, rise up. Folks, I can tell you, I learned a long time ago, you can wallow in your mess all the time, but Jesus says, get up. Get up. Pick up your bed and walk. I've given you my word. All you have to do is respond to it. Would you stand around the building? Charles Spurgeon once said, the Lord can do no more for you than you ask of him. I want you to hear me, listen. This poor man never asked anything of Christ except by his looks and by his lying there at the pool. Did you know you coming here when you're going through pain, when you're going through difficulty, when you're going through hardship? How many know the devil wants you to stay home? That's just what he does. Who hadn't fought that? Who hadn't fought? Raise your hand if you hadn't fought that. Everybody look around. You're going through hell. Devil just says stay. But I can tell you, sometimes you can't even articulate just how bad you need a touch of God. This man never said, I need touch. I need to be touched, Lord. His being at the pool testified to the fact that he did need something. He could have been out there on the lake on this Sunday morning. But he's here. Did you hear me? And you're here. You're here. So with every head bowed, every eye closed, I ask you, would thou be made whole? We've tried to pray. We've tried to seek the Lord. We've tried to minister under the Holy Ghost, sing under the Holy Ghost. We've tried to make this place as accessible for you to get to Christ. This morning, I feel in my spirit, you feel how easy it is right now to believe for your miracle. Right now, you feel in your spirit. Maybe before you got to church, you thought it was impossible, but in this very moment, you feel the possibility of God. If you're here, would you slip up your hand and say, Pastor, I want to be made whole. Hands going up around the building. I want to be made whole. My faith is there to believe God, to pick up my bed, to walk, to move forward with the Lord. These altars are open from the front to the back. Can we come give ourselves to the Lord? Can we say, Jesus, here I am. I'm no longer looking to man. I'm not looking to people. I'm looking to Christ, who is the only one that can deliver my soul.